call this meeting of the Committee on City Services and the City, Northampton City Council calls to order. And I'll ask the assistant to call the roll, please.
Counselor Bidwell?
Here.
Counselor Carney?
Present.
Counselor LaBarge?
Present.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Here.
And ask if there is any public comment. Seeing none, we have presentation today from the Public Safety Communication Center and from the Fire Rescue Department. So I'm gonna hand it over to the chief to start the presentation.
Yeah, I think if everyone's good, Kelly, I think needs to be somewhere later on, certainly on the colonel first.
Sure.
This is just a copy of my presentation.
Thank you.
Sure. So my name is Kelly Bannister. I'm the Director of Communications for the city. I've been in that position since 2010 and previously worked operations in dispatch. The Public Safety Dispatch Center, just to give you an overview, it's an all-civilian dispatch center located on the second floor of the fire department. It's a secure location. We are in compliance with the police department's accreditation process. We're staffed 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The full staffing, when we're up to it, is 10 dispatchers, one lead dispatcher, and myself. I work on Monday through Friday schedule. The lead dispatcher is assigned to days, and the dispatchers work with four days on and 2 days off schedule. So it's a rotating schedule. There's always two dispatchers on at a time, sometimes three. That's our minimum is two. And like all the other public safety departments, like the police and fire, we're subject to holdovers, and we are required to work weekends and holidays. Our services, we are the communication center for the police, fire, and EMS for the city of Northampton. That means that we answer all the 911 calls, the business lines, as well as the radio communications. We maintain site information for businesses in the city, so that would be the key holder information, so if there's a burglar alarm at 3 o'clock in the morning, we have somebody to call. We can also offer that to residences, especially if people have elderly or infirm family members that want to be contacted if we have to go over there or if we need a key location around. Instead of doing hide a key and putting it out over the radio, sometimes people just want to call their neighbor or call a family member to come down. We monitor fire alarms for over 165 businesses in the city, which also creates a revenue stream for the dispatch center that's put back into the salaries, as well as the fire alarm monitoring equipment. We monitor the burglar and fire alarms for city buildings, which ended up being a cost-saving measure for the city because it doesn't cost anything extra. We are also the after-hours contact for DPW, the parking department, city buildings, and animal control. Pretty much, we're there 24 hours a day, so they call us. And we also administer and send out messages over the reverse calling system. So the snow emergencies, if there's ever an emergency, we have to send out an all-call to all the residents. We can get that out there in a timely manner. So the radios, we monitor the main radio channel for the police department, the fire department, and operations channel for the fire department. We're responsible to make sure that all the officers and responders are safe and their transmissions are received and relayed. The DPW radio, we monitor after hours. We also dispatch a DPW after hours and call them in an off-duty, dependent on the emergency. We monitor the Western Mass law enforcement channels for police and fire, so we have capability to speak to all area departments at the same time. Like if we have a motor vehicle pursuit that our officer's following, we can get hold of all the area departments. And then we are also now involved in the city schools' emergency radios, so there's a portable in each one of the schools. Multiple personnel carry portable radios, so if they were having an emergency in the school, they can call us, they have direct contact to usurp the 911 system. Do you have any questions so far? I'm going kind of fast. Okay. This next screen, this is what the top picture is our radio, or our console for the 911 screen. On the left-hand side is the call taker screen. It's all done by computer. And the right-hand is a mapping software. So when a call is placed to 911, if you're calling from a landline, it's going to show your all of your information, the subscriber information, telephone, and address, and then plot it on the map with the closest address. If you're calling from a cell phone, it brings to Northampton Control, which they answer all the cell 911 calls, anything west of Worcester, and they transfer it to us. So then it then is displayed on the map. So we have five landlines on the 911 system, four cell phone lines, two administrative lines. We also have available to us in the residences a free interpreter service if it's an emergency situation. Within a minute or so, we can get an interpreter on the line. With the mapping program, and we have the ability to communicate with the deaf and hard of hearing. The next step in the 911 system is going to be next-gen 911, which the state is still currently in the process of implementing it. We probably won't see it for another year or two. But eventually down the road, that will give us capabilities to do text to 911. It's not something that we're going to get right away, though. Our business line, just like any other city business line, is voice over internet, but we come up with the copper backup, so if we ever have a failure in our phone system, which we had found was a big issue when our building got hit with lightning and it knocked out all of our phone system and our fire alarm monitoring. So that was one of the redundancies that we put into place. So our training program, we have a pretty extensive training program that we put in all of our employees. There's three bases. There's classroom, in-house, and on-the-job training. It's similar to what the police department does with their FTO program, but it does take 12 to 18 weeks to get a new employee ready for shift. So it is a very extensive program. We invest a lot into our employees because we really do, not to brag, but we have the elite dispatcher crew. I mean, we really have the cream of the crop because I think that these guys' lives are far too important to put it in the hands of someone that's not 100% capable. This is just a sample of the classes that we take. The Commonwealth only requires three classes. That's a basic telecommunicator class, a 911 class, and an emergency medical dispatch class. But we try to do as much training as possible for the dispatchers. Moving forward, the projects that we have coming up, we have gotten approval through the capital improvement to get a new radio consoles because ours is failing. It's antiquated. It's from 1999 when we first started the dispatch center. And with any technology, I mean, think about since 1999, how many computers and laptops you've gone through. It's the same platform. It's all computerized. So we'll be implementing that this year. It's a $375,000 project. But it's one of those we're looking down the road and into the future. It's a digital platform. So as we upgrade our radio systems, it's going to be compliant. We're going to be getting state new station alerting, which Chief will speak to you about. Whenever we have a call for the fire department, we tone them out to alert them that they have a call coming. That's a new thing that we're going to be implementing in the dispatch center. We have the new phone systems coming. We've also have combined efforts with police, fire, school, parking, central services, and DPW. It's a radio committee to identify all of our all of our capabilities and areas that need improvement in the radio system. So we're trying to really make it hardy and move into the future with digital radio systems. It's going to be a long-term project, but we've combined forces. And then the last thing we're doing is we're working with area police departments for mutual aid agreements. So if, God forbid, any area department has an active shooter situation, how can we improve the interoperability as far as radio communications and just on-scene operations? Our financial situation. So we have multiple funding sources for dispatch. We get the general fund currently $576,000, with $516,000 of that for personnel services and $60,000 for operation ordinary maintenance. We also received two grants from the State 911 Department, one for training for just over $16,000. These are non-competitive grants. They're available to every community that has an answering point. The training is used for employee salaries to attend training as well as classrooms. And then the support and incentive grant, which was $94,000. We can use that for salaries as well as items from within the dispatch center. So this past year we bought brand new chairs because ours were from 2007, and they're 24-hour chairs, so that costs about $6,000, and then the rest will go into salaries. We also have about $32,000 that we get from fire alarm monitoring fees. Again, that goes back into salaries and improving the system. And currently, where we stand, I have $28,690 left in my personnel services, so I'm projecting to have about $15,000 left over for the fiscal year. And then my ordinary maintenance, I have $13,866 left, which I'm projecting about $10,000 left over, and fire alarm monitoring, I have about $13,000 that will left over. So we'll have money to turn back into the general fund. So one of the biggest things that we try to explain to people is not all of our emergency calls come in on the 911 system. For 2015, calls that resulted in a police custody or police reports, 777 came in on the 911 lines, and the rest came in on the business lines, which was just under 2,000. So, I mean, that's a pretty big difference. And then the last page is just our numbers throughout the years, over a three-year period, how many arrests are we processed, how many reports, accidents, ambulance responses, and fire responses. So last year, we processed 42,425 calls for service. That's only calls that the actual responders go to. It doesn't count all of the business lines that have rang and all the 911 lines. It's actually very difficult to quantify how many times the business line rings because there's no way to see that. You know, we essentially are the clearinghouse. We're like a switchboard for the city. We may transfer to parking or records or down the fire department admin office. It's like all over the place, so it's hard to quantify. But we've seen a huge increase in our call volume lately. We're able to handle it right now with our staffing. We have really strong dispatchers, but they're busy. The phone doesn't stop sometimes, so. That's all I have. Do you guys have any questions or want any points of clarification?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, sure.
At one time with Chief Brian Duggan, wherever there was a fire, no matter what ward it was, the counselor was notified. Mm-hmm. And I've noticed that this is not happening.
I think it's because we really haven't had any structure fires. I mean, we had a couple, and I can let the chief speak to that. But those were more of the major, where the community was impacted or a ward citizen was impacted. But I don't think we've had any structure fires, have we?
We've had some small structure fires, but nothing of any significance.
Because I remember the one on Whittier, mm-hmm. never got notified on that one, and Fire Chief Brian Duggan did call me late that evening, and I said, well, residents notified me on that one, and that was a terrible one.
Mm-hmm. And as you know, I mean, because there were so many injuries in that fire, the dispatchers, there were only two dispatchers working that night, and not only are they handling that incident and trying to get mutual aid in, but they're handling all the other emergencies, so it's possible that they got busy or they weren't prompted to call. I mean, that's something that I can try to remind the dispatchers to call the ward rep. And I just recently got a ward rep list, contact information.
Great. Okay.
Well, thank you very much. Like you say, you are the dispatch for the entire the switchboard for the whole city. So you're obviously dealing with an enormous amount. So thank you. And thank you for taking the time to come today. Also, appreciate it. You just mentioned you had an uptick in total number of calls.
We have.
Do you have any idea why? Just out of curiosity.
It actually seems like there's been a larger increase in medical calls, oddly enough, but I'm not sure why. Hmm. I don't know if Deputy Garrett has any. So he'll have some numbers for you. A lot of business line phone calls. We recently, within the past year, we took over the business line for the fire department, whereas people were able to call down to the administrative office directly. The published number, which is 1032, rings to dispatch, so we handle all those now. So that also increased our call volume.
Okay. And so as your call volume goes up, I'm curious about your state funding, the little amount that you get. Has that been pretty much constant over the last...
It has been. We're not entirely guaranteed to get those grants from year to year. That's really dependent on the state budget. The way that where that revenue source comes from is all the, when you look at your cell phone bill, you have like a 75 cent charge, they bumped it up to $1.50 because they had to come up with the money for the next gen project. And that's actually where our training grant and support and incentive grant money comes from. And as we're seeing more people get cell phones, we see more, obviously more revenue from that. But our grants are based on our 911 call volume, how many times 911 physically rings, not our business line.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, and it's funny because a lot of people call the business line for calls for service, as we talked about earlier.
Okay.
Sure. Yes.
You talk about increasing the mutual aid response capacity. What's the nature of it now?
Police mutual aid is very rare. The times that we will actually use police mutual aid is if there's a large fight, and that's a matter of just calling the area community or state police and they come in and it's done in like 20 minutes or so. Whereas a fire mutual aid, a fire call is more in depth and it's a longer period. They have pre-written agreements with the surrounding communities, and we actually have a run order. So If it's a medium-sized fire, we may have to call three area communities to come in. It's all predetermined. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, and does it seem adequate now on the fire side?
Yes, for the fire side, I would say that, yes, it's adequate. You know, occasionally we'll tweak it here and there, depending on what kind of equipment is available, you know, if an area community. For instance, we ended up adding more tankers to an out-of-water district fire run car, and that's to get more water to the scene.
Yeah, we have a 10-alarm run card that was developed. It's been in play for years. So basically, we could go out to like 10 alarms. I go back to the night of, you know, the Anthony Bay fires in 2009, where we actually ran through those 10 alarms and actually activated it. So I never thought in my career that I would see that actually used and exercised, and it worked well. And I hope we don't see it. And as Kelly said, we do review it at times. I know when I took over last year, Assistant Chief Davin and I took a look at it. And, you know, just with the different changes in the communities and equipment, we tweaked it out a little bit, but it's been pretty much the mainstay for what we developed basically back in, I think, about 2000 when we developed it. And it seems to work really well. And most communities around have that type of kind of run car set up.
And we also have ambulance mutual aid agreements as well.
Yes. Kelly, on your staffing, do they stay long? Do they get burnt out?
We actually will see, this is a good question, it's a really good question. We see burnout period between 5 and 7 years, and that's due to the schedule and the types of calls that they're seeing. So we try to re-engage them, get them involved in more training. They actually, some dispatchers take on more responsibility, they'll do the training, or they become trainers, or they may do the QA on the medical calls. We actually have, I would say 75% of my staff has been there for over 5 years. And I would say probably 40% over 10 years. It seems like we have the same rotating last three positions. My last two dispatchers that left were 5-year veterans, and they end up going into different job fields.
What are the hours, like 7 to 3, then 3 to 11?
We're actually offset from the police department by an hour, so we work 8 to 4, 4 to midnight, midnight to 8. And the reason being is if a call comes in at 2:45, a new force of officers are there, but the dispatcher still has that hour and 25 layover, so they get there familiar with the call.
So you have enough of staffing, so if somebody called in sick and could not make the third shift hours, does the second shift stay over, or how do you work that?
Yeah, we have a system in place. We actually use Code Red, the reverse calling, and we put out a call to all the dispatchers to see if anybody wants to voluntarily come in. And then if no one voluntarily takes it, then we force. But we try to do 4-hour blocks to eliminate that burnout period. The majority of my staff are young parents, so we try not to hold them too long. We try to be fair. And we do it on a rotating schedule.
I want to thank you, Kelly, for everything you do at that department. As long as I've been a city councilor, I mean, and dispatch came in, we've just are progressively just doing great with it.
Thank
and
you.
I want to thank you and your staff.
That means a lot. Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
Okay, thank you, Kelly.
I'm going to stay a little bit for your time here.
Really?
The ball game got canceled.
So I know Pam said that probably some interest was the North Street fires, as we call them over there, and the situation we had. I can give you a quick update on that. Basically, the update is thankfully we haven't had any more fires in that area since late March, and you know, things seem to be quieted down over there. But I can assure you that we're certainly still have surveillance going on, and the police department is certainly doing extra patrols through the area and keeping an eye on. The other day, actually last Friday, we had a dumpster fire right at was on the Bates Street side of Industrial Drive, but that turned out to be basically workmen. It was either their process of removing the roofing, they were doing roofing up there and using grinders to take off the fasteners. What we limited it down to was basically them grinding it, or it was careless disposal of smoking materials from the workers. So I was glad to be able to determine that fire out there and down to those causes. But everything's been pretty quiet over there for the most part, so I know Ryan, hopefully things have quieted down for your residents a little bit, and hopefully fears are kind of taken back a little and people are resting easy, so.
And if I may, I'll take this opportunity to say thank you again for helping provide as much information as possible to the residents of Ward 3. I mean, the community meeting at the beginning of April, and that was very much appreciated, so thank you.
Yeah, and just to, I think probably to give a little background on, I know Chief Casper and myself, early on, basically by fire investigators, what we do is we track fires in the city, just to give everyone a little history with that. So as fires come in, part of their job and responsibility is just to see where the locations are. And with the North Street neighborhood, it was in early March that basically we identified there was a small area in the city that we had numerous fires that we couldn't identify what the cause was. So we brought that forward, and Chief Casper and I talked about that, and we felt that it was responsible and probably a good thing to get out to the community just so we could have awareness. Because the best thing is people that live in the neighborhood know what's going on, and you know, they know who's going through and what's different and things like that. So it was really an outreach to the neighborhood to see if they could keep their eyes open and give us any leads or any potential problems out through there. So we made the decision to go forward early with that, and I think it was, you know, taken good. The community meeting I thought was good. So yeah, we were just looking to be proactive with it. Really with those fires that we had over there, I can honestly say that we haven't linked them all. It was just basically the proximity of all the fires and basically not being able to determine what the cause was is why we brought that forward and kind of brought it to the public to give them that awareness out there. But things seem to be quieted down over there, so you know, hopefully we'll still monitor the situation. And I know PD's still got some extra patrols going on, and our detective that's assigned to fire investigation is still keeping an eye on the neighborhood and has some surveillance equipment and stuff up out through there. So we're still staying on it, and we'll keep track of it and keep going. And you know, we just want to keep everybody safe as we go forward out through there. So.
Yes, I know we're working very closely with Chief Jody Casper past couple of weeks, and I don't know if you got that email and the pictures of what's occurring in Ward 6, and apparently the neighbors have taken pictures on site of what's happening out there on the extension of Park Hill Road in the field. And it actually shows the pit, it shows all the beer bottles, everything, the burning and all that going on at midnight. The kids really raising a lot of rumpus out there. So I don't know if things have quieted down, but you were supposed to have been notified. Have you been notified?
Chief Casper had we had a conversation about that. They say there's basically a party spot for
we don't know what it is.
Teenagers, and she was having her officers basically keep an eye out through there. So.
Yeah, okay. Because the neighbors are very concerned because of the houses.
Yeah, absolutely. It seems to be in that between the extensions, what's going on there. So, yeah, Jody did let me know on that. So,
okay,
we're keeping an eye on it. So, just moving forward with that capital project to keep you up to date there. First, I'd like to say thank you to all the counselors for approving that fire engine. I really appreciate that. The new engine. I got Deputy Chief McQuestion, who's going to chair the committee for me, because we have a group of firefighters that will be specking out the truck. So we actually had a meeting this morning on it, and they're starting to move forward with that. But that new engine is going to replace our engine 2 up in Florence, which is 10 years old. And one of the things that we're looking at is seeing it's going to be up in kind of Ward 6 and 7 is the use of technology. And one of the some of the neat things out there, they got foam systems. It's called a compressed air foam system that we're going to definitely buy on this truck, which will certainly, I think, help Ward 6 and 7 with the long driveways and the bigger homes out there and the limited water supply. What the foam system does is it basically it extends the use of your water. So basically, we say 1,000 gallons of water with a compressed air foam system, you could probably have 3,000 gallons of extinguishing agent. It's not an end-all, do-all, but it's another tool in our toolbox that we could utilize. And especially out in those wards there, we certainly have some bigger homes with some longer driveways and a little bit difficult areas to get to. That I think it'll prove them, you know, hopefully we never have to use it, but it will hopefully be a useful tool that if we have a situation out there, we'll be able to handle that But thank you very much. Like I said, engine 2 is 10 years old, and just going by the service plan and stuff, it's time for that to retire and go to the reserve status. And this truck was timely right on spot. So by the time we get that, it'll probably be 11 years old and ready to retire. But the new truck, like I said, we're looking at some different features on it that will help make it in the Florence area a little bit more useful. The compressed air foam system, we're talking about some rear dumps and things, because we really have our guys training on rural water supply, which is basically moving water with trucks and using portable bags, portable tanks. And we did a whole training component over the last year with that to be prepared for those areas that we have limited water supply out there. So that's kind of moving forward there, and I'm very happy and thankful that we're getting that, because I think it was needed. Yeah, that'll put us in a really good spot apparatus-wise for the department. The other capital plan that we had was communication equipment, and that's just going to help us improve our radios out through there. One of the things is the city has a citywide radio committee that basically police, fire, DPW, we have central services and schools on board, where we just started to meet and really looking at the city's radio system as a whole. Because before, in the past, it was kind of each department looked at their own needs and situations and equipment in kind of their own light. But we put together a committee that, which is chaired by Kelly, to really look at it as a whole, so that as we go forward, to making sure that if we buy portable radios, they're compatible with the police department, or you know, the school department's, you know, compatible to talk to dispatch and things like that. So that money for there, I think we got $32,000, will just help us upgrade our radios and our pager system. I got pagers that are well over 10 years old. They're about three generations behind of what's going on out there. So that will help us upgrade and get us to a good spot communication-wise. And the first thing is, like all my deputy chiefs on shift, we're going to upgrade their radios so they have the most current technology and be able to help them out do their job there. The door entry system and the station alerting, that was basically essential service items that were for our station. The door entry system basically is the FOB system that we call it, the keyless entry, so that we can get in there. Our current system is about 15 years old. We can't buy any hardware for it, and we actually do have a couple problems out there that I'm talking to David Pomerantz about this moving forward quick, because if something breaks, basically we can't get parts anymore. So that was a very much needed thing there. And that's part of actually police accreditation that that they look at with dispatch being in our facility, is that we have a secure facility and being able to track who comes and who goes. So that was very good to get going. And station alerting, basically, as Kelly said, that's the system that basically alerts us to a call. And I got Assistant Chief Davin, who's kind of put that together for us and moving forward with that. The current system we have basically has been there since 1999 when we built the station. And literally when we say it's held together with, I would say, duct tape.
Hey, cross fingers.
It really is. And so we're replacing that up and out. I know if we need to do a service call to repair that, the company comes out of New Hampshire, but it's very expensive, because they charge us from when they leave up there, and it's a minimum, I'd say, of $500.
Oh, easy.
Just for them to come
down. The minimum?
A minimum, just to get them on the road.
Because we pay mileage and travel time.
So I guess if Assistant Chief David just wants to say some of the features of the new system that we have, that would be...
Sure, so the new station alerting system, like the apparatus committee, we got a couple of firefighters together. We looked at several different vendors, and the company that we chose to work with, Purvis, is actually right just south of us in Connecticut. So they're close by. Boston Fire actually uses them. And one of the people that I spoke to about Purvis was the former dispatch director who built our dispatch center, Jim Lake. I don't know if anybody remembers him, but he's down in Charleston, South Carolina. And they just bought the Purvis system, and he loves it. So it's a computerized dispatch system. It has a computerized voice to dispatch our folks. And then once they get out and sign on the air, then they'll be talking to the dispatchers. But it's going to be a little bit quicker getting us out the door. And we've got some features. The firefighters really like that. If you remember back to the old emergency TV show and the ticker tape, it actually spits out the address and you can rip off the printer. And they wanted it. I mean, I thought it was kind of going backwards, but the guy said, no, we can write notes on it. And a lot of times you'll hear our folks when they go on a call, they'll be calling dispatch, what was that address again? What was that apartment number again? So hopefully that'll eliminate that when they have it in their hand. So that's just some of the features. You know, it should be pretty neat. We'll hopefully get that started in soon. We have a meeting next week, so. Because the one we have now is literally plugged in with Scotch tape.
This will be neat that there'll be actually displays on the apparatus floor, so when you come down, it'll tell you the location of the call. We'll give you
who was dispatched, a map.
Yeah, yeah. So it gives you a map in the city. So I think it's going to be a really useful tool for our people. Like the ticker tape, as we say, is ripping off that. You know, I think we all like to see something hard copied, and the guys really like to see that. But it should be pretty neat that, you know, they'll come down, they'll basically tell you the call, the nature, and then give you the map in the area so that, you know, you'll be able to get yourself orientated to where you're going to. So I think it's going to be a pretty useful tool for us. And as John says, the hope is we'll get out the door a little bit quicker, and you know, help the guys do their jobs a lot easier out there. Moving on to operations. Basically, I got fire prevention and use of technology. One of the cool things that I was really happy to see when I took over as chief is the desire in the department to start really using technology to help us do our job out there. And fire prevention is a big area that is really kind of took off under the guidance of Assistant Chief Davin. Basically, we're using iPads to do inspections out in the field. And it was pretty cool that he kind of put the program together and has it moving forward. So basically, when we go out and do the 26F inspections, which are for the sale of a home, we have all the shifts using them out there. We can basically email the certificate to the real estate agent if they want. So basically, we really can say we go truly wireless. But John, if you want to say a few words.
Sure. Yeah, so you know, one of the chief's initiatives when we started was we generate a lot of paper, especially in fire prevention with our permitting and, you know, between gas stations and businesses and propanes and oil burners, I mean, we generate a lot of paper. And as we were going out there before we started with our new software, you know, we went out and did an inspection for a home sale. The realtor or the resident would get the yellow copy, and then we would bring back the green copy. So as you can imagine, we have many, many drawers full of green copies. So now, as the chief said, all our folks are out there using iPads. They do the inspection. The inspection paperwork is on our software, emergency response software, and they just check the boxes. Everything passes, and they can just email it to the resident and email it to the realtor. And we don't have it's logged into ERS, and we don't have to bring back a green copy and file it. And a lot of times we bog down our young interns with filing green copies. We're doing the same thing with gas stations. We're sending out our permits that way instead of, you know, putting them. A lot of the stuff, you know, it takes time. You have to type it all out, put it in an envelope, put a stamp on it, and mail it. So now we can collect the money, and we can just email them their permits. So
right then and there.
Yeah, and it saves so much time and so much work. You know, especially, you know, with the college, we do a ton of inspections and paperwork up the college. So much easier to just bring an iPad, email it to them, and be done with it. And then we have everything. We don't have to do an inspection, take notes, come back, and then type up the violations. We can just click boxes, send it to them. And we have the ability to take pictures. So a lot of times, like liquor license inspections are big. You know, we take those very seriously. And if we have a violation, I can just take a picture of it with the iPad. And when I email it to the bar owner or the business owner, they get the report and they've got a picture. So
what would
violation
be for liquor?
If they have exit lights that are out, or you know, they're not supposed to use extension cords.
See, yeah, we see a lot of electrical.
A lot of electrical stuff.
Basically, use of extension cords aren't allowed. We do those with the building inspector, with Louie. And so it's a neat, it's a combined effort when we go out there.
Yeah, so if they ask me, well, what light was out? I said, well, it's right there in the picture. You have the picture of it. So it works out really well. So far, it's worked really well. This new software we started using in January, and we keep track of everything on it. It's our shift strength, our payroll, everything. We've got our inventory in there now. We're inventory every piece of hose. We're just finishing up testing our hose for the year. So we gave each hose a number, we've been able to enter it into this software, so we'll be able to track it, so we know the age of it and everything. EMS equipment's going in here, air packs, so we have a one-stop shop, which is an ERS training. All of our, if our folks attend training, it all gets logged in and under their name. We have pictures, their IDs in there, their driver's license. It'll send us a little note and say, oh, you know, the chief's driver's license expires Tuesday, happy birthday, we'll get a new license. EMT cards, you know, everything. We really wanted to get into one software. Our folks can actually, it's web-based, so our firefighters can access it from home. You know, if they want a vacation day, they don't have to call the station and talk to the officer in charge and say, hey, how many people are off tomorrow? Can I get the day off? They can actually log into the software and look at the shift strength for the next day and say, oh, nobody's on vacation, I can take the day off. You know, so it's actually worked out really well as far as going paperless and trying to cut down on all the paperwork.
But then that's documented somewhere else.
That's
correct?
Documented in our software, and if we ever need, you know, if we need to pull up the permit, we just look up the business, pull it up, and we can print out the permit. So we scan everything. If I get, so for liquor licenses, for instance, every year they have to have their alarm system tested. So they have them email me that paperwork that says such and such company did the test on this date and it passed. I'll get that paperwork in my email, and then I just upload it into their business in ERS. So instead of, and that's another thing, we would take that, put it in the file, add it to, you know, Packard's, and Packard's files like this big, you know, so everything's just here. If we need it for some reason, we can just print it out. But we don't have
so it's worked out really, really well, and I gotta say the staff was really great about accepting it and moving forward with it. I mean, a couple of things when I took over as chief, I could never tell you how many pieces of hose I had or what we have for equipment. So the goal is, and we're working towards that, is to get everything logged in there so that we know what we have for an inventory of every piece of equipment that we have, so we can keep track of that. As John said, for inspections, it's really, efficiency-wise, has been enormous that we're not going out taking notes and then coming back and doing a Word document and sending it out. It's really, we finish the inspection, we almost basically, you know, what's your email address, and then we almost email it off, and then when you're basically in your car driving away, you're done. It's documented into the program, we can recall that, and the whole goal of this is really kind of to help basically the shift deputies when they're out on the street, that if we have an emergency, a fire, or some other type of tragedy out there, that they can pull it up and see what's going on with the building. So, you know, when did we last go through it, their inspection reports, and they can see all that information. They'll be able to pull it up in the middle of the night so that they have access. Yeah. And again, it's all trying to help our people get the information they need to do their job. So that's working really well. One of the other things that we tried to do was really looking at, you know, people are liking the ability to go online and schedule things and take care of it that way. Through Schedulosity, a program that we had used for our car seat program. We were able to adapt off of that and basically come up with a schedule to do smoke detector inspections. So if anybody wants to schedule a smoke detector inspection, they can go on our website and then they can pick out a time and schedule it out. So it's really helped Melissa, our administrative assistant, with cutting down on the phone calls, and people, what we've heard from the real estate agents, is they really like the ability to go in, see when it's available, schedule it, and take care of it that way. And so that's proven really, really useful out there.
Yeah.
And it's been really great to see that, you know, we've kind of moved forward, I say. I'm not the techiest guy out there, but it's kind of cool seeing some of the things that we're able to do. And it's really, efficiency-wise, it's really made our guys more efficient.
We have one of our younger firefighters who's way more tech-savvy than us.
Yeah.
Putting in all our documents and everything, so, you know, letterheads and permits and everything, he's the one taking care of getting all that in there for us, because if we had to do it, we'd still be,
be
struggling through it. But he's doing a great job for us. And then just kind of an operations update so far, as of about 5 minutes ago, we're up to 2,314 calls for service. That's both fire and EMS as of right now. We took delivery of our new rescue truck at the beginning of the year. So that, you know, that rescue carries all of our specialized equipment. It's got a hitch on it so we can tow our boat, we can tow our decon trailer. It's got a really magnificent lighting package if we need to, you know, at night, if we need a lot of times, you know, if you have a fatal car accident or something, police department need us out there for lights, so we'll bring that out there and set that up for them. Carries all our water rescue, ice rescue stuff. So we took delivery of that, did the training, and that's in service now. We're hiring two more firefighters starting, hopefully they'll be starting in...
Probably hopefully the 1st of June.
1st of June. We just lost one firefighter to Agawam Fire, and we may be losing another one to Agawam Fire here soon, so...
They're going to Agawam?
Yeah, they go down there.
Yeah, I guess they pay a little bit better, but we've lost a lot of firefighters to different places, so we're used to it. You know, we bring in a new one, and
I think we've slowed a little bit. I hate to say that it's generational, but it seems like we're hiring some people that years ago when I was hired 29 years ago, if you got hired, you didn't think of leaving, but. It seems like the younger generation, they're a little bit more transient, and money and things like that they'll look at, and that's with Agawam, where I've asked both individuals, why did they go, and it really came down to money.
Well, that's what people look at.
Yeah.
Is the money part of it?
Yeah, and it's and honestly, it's hard.
The living.
And we find it very difficult to hire paramedics. Mm-hmm. I mean, you'll get people that just want to be paramedics, but we need them to be firefighters and paramedics.
Yeah.
Or you get, these young folks that just want to be firefighters. Well, that's great, but we run three ambulances 24/7. So, it's hard. It's difficult to hire good people. It seems like we maybe got a couple local people this time around. But, when you hire people from, Cambridge and Lexington, when something opens up back home, they book it for back home. So... I can't say as I blame. A lot of them are young. They don't have families. They don't have any ties to the city. So, they're like
I joke with other fire chiefs. I say we pillage from each other.
Yeah, that's all we do. We steal from each other.
There's a small pool of paramedics, and we all compete for them. So,
police department has the same problem.
They're in the same boat.
They'll leave the police department because they'll go to the state police, which is more money.
Yeah,
better benefits.
Yeah.
We just finished up with the extravaganza at the fairgrounds on Saturday. We had an ambulance down there with a deputy and a command post. Things went well. We have an after-action meeting on Thursday morning to kind of discuss that, see what went right, what went wrong, and probably plan for next year. I would assume we'll probably do it again next year.
Traffic was an issue.
Traffic was an issue, but for us on the fire side, things were fine. We had 15 medical calls down there.
We
mostly
transported about 30 something. We actually treated.
Yeah.
It was most blew out. It was dehydration.
Dehydration. It was a warm day.
Started
a lot
of IVs on people down there.
Nothing crazy. I know the police department had a robbery and an arrest, but for us it was kind of a business as usual. Beginning of the year, we promoted several new officers. We've got a new deputy chief, several new captains. So we're in the process of getting our new officers trained. A lot of incident command stuff and some new officer training. And I think that is really all I have. If anybody has any questions, operations-wise?
So I think one of the things just to finish up operations is Chief Casper and I, we had a pretty good relationship. I think both departments are working really well. It's kind of neat that we've worked on a few collaborative efforts together, and I think on the street it shows that we basically have some good people out there and we're working together, and it's pretty unique, I think.
That's important.
Yeah, you see it now with the Unified Command Post. We started it with New Year's Eve probably three years ago. We get that mobile command post from MEMA. We bring a dispatcher in, police commander, fire commander. And they all work together in that command post. Works great on New Year's Eve. Worked well at the extravaganza. We had the hot chocolate run that we're going to do. Pride parade. So we do have a lot of big events in the city, and that unified command post, which was never done before, has really worked well.
It's been a great way to really manage an event. It's really, we got police and fire in there, and we're using state assets that are available to us, so it's really no cost to the city when we bring that in, but it's a great way to manage these large-scale events or larger events out there.
And it's really good practice for...
In case we have something big, if I knock on wood, we're good, but.
Yeah, we theoretically create our own little city at that event. We have dispatch, police, fire, and that's all they worry about is that event, and then the rest of the city continues as business as usual. So far, it's worked out well.
So moving on to EMS, I got Deputy Chief Garapi here. When I took over as chief last July, Chris Norris, who was doing our EMS, elected to go back to shift and work there. So John kind of came in at a transitional time when we had a lot of things happening, and I'll let him talk about kind of what he's done over the last 7-8 months.
I'm told the clip don't work.
Yeah, that can go a long way, if you know me. So the biggest one, so the new EMS billing, this is actually, the city had the last billing company that they were with for over 10 years. So they had to go out for a request for a proposal under procurement laws, and unfortunately, our last company that we've been with all these years, they were off. So the new company, they were at 3% of our total revenue of billing. The new company that we have came at 2.95, so they won the bid. So it's still a work in process. I never would have dreamed that changing one billing company to the other could be the I don't want to say nightmare, but it is a lot of work. It is filing with every insurance company you do business with, changing paperwork with them, Medicare, MassHealth. It's still, I started October 1st when I got sworn, I'm still this day dealing with changing over the billing.
So it's amazing. We were with the other company for probably 12 years.
Yeah, 12 years, yeah.
And you know, we had things in play, and over time, as insurance companies came on board, we got the proper paperwork.
Yep.
And when we did this change, I didn't anticipate, and I know John didn't either, but it was the amount of paperwork to switch over to Medicare and, you know, Blue Cross and Blue Shield, and working with a new company to get processes done. And it's all information for billing. Working with a hospital to get some information to the billing company and what needs to be done, the releases and things. So.
And he actually got us so much, 100 and...
Yeah, there's a state program out there that basically it was a rebate for Medicaid.
Yeah, Medicare, municipal ambulance providers.
So it was only available to municipalities. John worked with Susan Wright and did a phenomenal amount of effort. It was basically, I don't know how many reports it was, they wanted to know cost of, you know, what it costs to run an ambulance, you know, what did we do for call numbers, and it was way more in depth than that. But John pulled that together, and we should be getting...
In June, we're getting a little over $118,000.
Yeah, $118,000 in that program from the state, which was pretty good.
That's excellent.
That's one of the first things he gave me my first month on the job.
I had to talk to him for a few times to tell him it's okay.
He walked me off the wall a couple of times.
Talked him off the ledge.
But he did a great job pulling that together. I know Susan Wright gave him a lot of information and helped him work through it, so it's all on them. The two of them did it, so.
And now she's so valuable. She is a very smart woman.
Yeah,
absolutely. I talk to Susan quite regularly. She is, for some reason, I don't know how she knows it, she knows it, so she's amazing, absolutely.
She
So we're still working. We're still working with the billing company. The chief and I review that stuff monthly. The problem is right now, one of the big things you look for in billing is what they call the collection ratio. So out of $100, are we able to, you know, what percentage of that $100 are we able to collect, you know, between the bad debt, writing things down, you know, we were at 92% to 94% is where we were. I can't give you that number right now because we haven't been with this new company long enough to give them, you know, they had to put money in. Some companies you wait 90 days to get money back, so we're 120. So we don't have a consistent flow yet. So we are working on that, and I am in contact with Susan Wright on it all the time. So we'll see.
So even with the switchover, as John said, it's amazing the lag between like when we bill and when you'll get paid. And like John said, some companies you can see like a 90-day turnover, and things will come along. But we're actually seeing it's probably a little bit longer.
Yep.
We're about 7 months into it, and we're just starting to see the numbers start to creep up to where they really need to be and should be. So we informed the mayor when we switched and Susan that, you know, this, you're going to see that lag in revenue, but we're real hopeful that I think in the next 3 months before the end of the fiscal year, we'll get that rate back up to where it should be. So
last the month of March when we first we swapped in October, we stopped our billing completely, went to a new company. It wasn't until March that we actually saw We average somewhere about $150,000 a month of what we bring in. Well, that last month was the first time we saw $120,000 come in the door, so it took that long to get everything to transition. I'm hoping that the next 2 days I'll see April's numbers, and hopefully for April we're up in that area, and like that's our first chunk of real good numbers that we're getting. But I watch it like a hawk, track it. It's basically that's my job. So, you know, it's part of my big chunk of it, but yeah, to watch those numbers. Next thing we did is upgrade our software. We use a different software than the Fireside does. It's a medical-based software. We use that. That was our original software. There is an upgrade that came out with it. It actually costs us nothing to do at this point because we pay a service contract, and it was part of our service contract. It came out about a year and a half ago. We never implemented it because we needed the new servers to go in, but with Dave Tripp and the Antonio putting the new servers in, we're able to now upgrade our new software. So like I said, it's a free upgrade, and it is. I just got it on my machine today. I have to train everybody, but it's going to give us better information on tracking history, being able to figure out when maybe we need to up staff on certain hours, and hopefully it'll give us a better idea of where we've been and where we're going. So and honestly, it's going to make it easier for the crews, and by helping them with the tedious part of this report writing, to give them more time to actually have better patient care. I mean, our crews are second to none in all Western Mass. I'll tell you that right now. I work with everybody.
So what it'll help our crews do is it gives more patient history out to the field. So if we transport the gamma or see them, it's able to recall that. So they can see kind of patient history and what's going on with the patient, and help them that way. Probably the other biggest component, I think, is data. We're able to take this new, and we're able to kind of narrow it down and help define what we want to track. So like John explained to me today, of the old system was, did we start an IV? Yes. Well, now we can say, did you start an IV? Yes. Okay, where did you start an IV, and in what location of the body, and help define us, and we can get a better picture, I think, of what our people are doing out there. So I'm pretty excited. I think it's going to help us really track. As he said, we've got some real talented people out there, but it'll help give us a picture, I think, of what we're doing in the field, and it'll give them that basically back picture too for the patient. So it was really driven by patient care of how we want to move forward.
And then with that upgrade, we've also gone ahead and added the mobile hotspots in our ambulances. So before, we used to have to wait for the ambulance to back into the station so it could update. What one ambulance does is it speaks to all five ambulances talk to each other. So if I pick up a guy on Main Street, and 2 hours later they get released from the hospital, and then another ambulance picks them up, they actually have that same information now. They're sharing. So by going to mobile hotspots, and I didn't realize how cheap it was to do this, because the city buys a block of data. It's only $11 a truck to buy the hotspot to be able to grab into that block of data. And we're only taking text information. We're not like streaming video or anything. So what we're using is a minuscule amount of data. It's literally costing me $55 a month to have all these trucks talk to each other 24/7. So it was really, really cheap to do. I was surprised. So that's good. I'm kind of cheap guy, so I'll do that all day long. So we did the MiFis and the ambulances. The other thing is the chief and came to us, when he came in with John and myself, he wants paperless. We want to be able to share data. We don't want to have to look for a form. I can announce as of this week, the last form we had for ambulances was the ambulance checklists. I was able to design a program myself through Google Docs and use the Google spreadsheets that they're doing their checklists through that, and then they're emailing them to me in a PDF format. We're saving them. I just did a training. I have one more group tomorrow, but we're going to be all paperless. The state requires us to do a weekly checklist on the ambulance. They're doing this all on the laptops in the truck now, emailing them off. No more printing of forms, no more having to file the paper or anything again. And then the crews can go back. Instead of me being the only one to have with the file cabinet full of them that people can have to come in and look, they can pull it up on their smartphones and look at it right then and there. So that was one of the big things. We are finally paperless now for the ambulances. So, and it helps share more information. So,
what about if there was a problem with legality here? Where do you get all this information? Say that, because I know there was an incident way back, and I'm not going to go into details, but how do you give that information to attorneys and so forth?
Oh, so actually, I didn't really even talk about this. But so one of the things is, all our our emails are public information.
Right.
Well, I share a lot of information through my emails that are privacy laws. So I have a confidential notice on, but I was researching it. That confidential notice doesn't even help me. So what we did, we used to have attorneys send in letters requesting patient information. So every, believe it or not, every car accident you ever see, believe me, there's an attorney sending me a request for that ambulance report. I'm not kidding you. It's like 100%. I'm telling you, it's amazing. So I see an MVC come across my desk, and I was just print it out and get ready to give it to the attorney. Because there's somebody going to ask for that. I guarantee it. It might even take 5 years, but they'll get it. One of the things I put in for a software system is called ChartShare. And all the attorneys use them. So all your major attorneys in the area are on this system. What they do is they do a HIPAA release form with their client. They scan it and they email it to me through this system. It's separate than the city system and ever. I'm the only, me and then the chief has an account to it as my backup. But we're the only two with access to it, and it's outside the city system. Simple. I get the request. Yeah, that's one of our people we took. I upload a PDF format copy of the run report. The neat thing about the system, it also does our billing, because we charge for that report, public information. So I charge them $15. What it does is it sends them back an email saying, Northampton Fire Rescue says, yes, they have it, and they've uploaded the form. Before they can download the form, they have to go in and they have to be paid through a PayPal or a credit card to this company. And they're paying what they're paying for is their, so it's a $15 fee to me, they're paying this chart swap a $5 convenience fee. ChartSwap collects all the money, and then once a month they send a check into the city for our $15. I don't have to track the accounting on it. They take care of tracking for it, and every, all the software, all the HIPAA privacy. I learned about it through Boston EMS was using it, and they had great success with it, and that's what we're using now. And like I said, I sit back and just collect the money. It's really easy, you know, where before I'd have to send a bill and then track who paid what attorney and send a reminder notice. And,
As we talk about going paperless and that, John found this program that literally, basically, we get a letter from an attorney requesting a report, and we generate an invoice, print the report, we send it out, then you know they send a check into us, we have to go back in, say it's paid, and done all that. It's really taken care of through this program right now.
Yeah.
It's all tracked for us, and basically, John just can upload it, and then when they pay, they get their record that they're looking for,
yeah.
And then they keep track of the accounting for us and send us a check on that.
Yeah, so
I mean, I couldn't believe how many of these he gets. Like, it's almost laughable.
Yeah.
And how much time he would actually spend before this, you know, researching the call. All right, did we transport that person? Now I got to print it out. Now I got to send him a bill. And I mean, it's just mind-numbing how much time.
You know.
And he's right. Like, literally every car accident, we get a request.
Everyone, and it might be take them 2 years, and they talk to somebody and go, you need to get a lawyer. And they'll actually, I got stuff that goes back 3-5 years sometimes. They're just asking for stuff now, you know. And it's amazing. It blows my mind. I've learned so much in this job in such a short time about people. So yeah, there's a lot of attorneys. I swear to God, we have more attorneys than we have people smashing up cars, because they almost fight for these people sometimes. So we are. That is one of the things we did paperless. The other thing that we used in EMS was. We allow students to ride with us from other programs, and the John and the chief brought, we were talking about Schedulosity. We use that now for scheduling our students to ride with us. The students are allowed to ride one student every day for 12 hours, in the, you know, 8 in the morning, 8 at night, because as a paramedic, you have to do rounds, so you have to do so many hours on an ambulance. Before, what they would do is send me an email as a deputy chief, say, chief, do you have what date? I can ride this date, and I'd have to look and go, now they're all full, email them back, say, fix new dates. With the Schedulosity program, which we already had in place, we're able to put a separate calendar up for paramedic student ride time, and the students can go in there, yep, this day's open, book it, it sends me an email to confirm it, but that's about it, there's not a lot, and the advantage to us having these paramedic students riding with us is we get to see potential new employees down the road. So we make a list, I'll be honest with you. My guys out in the field say, hey, if this guy ever applies, you should look at him. So it allows us to kind of pre-scan some of these applicants that's coming in the door. So
it's kind of a neat program that basically with Greenfield Community and Springfield College, with their programs, as they graduate or as they finish up their program, they got to do field time. So we bring students in and have them ride with us. Basically, our paramedics work as mentors and basically evaluate them. So it's kind of a neat program, as John said, that we get to see students as they come through. And
the good and the bad.
We see the good and the bad. But, you know, we can evaluate them. We know who's good. And it's actually a neat way to market the department. We've had a lot of students come through and go, wow, you guys have a really good department here, and this is a place I'd like to work. So it works out to our advantage. And John streamlined that down pretty well, where it was another cumbersome process for him that he spent a lot of time on. That, you know, basically we only allow one student a day, so we don't burden our people down with trying to get too much done. But it's basically running on his own. John manages it, checks it, just makes sure everything's good with it, and we're good to go. So.
And then the last thing I'll go through quick is I printed out with.
I'd make a quick call. Can I look? Here you go. Sorry about that.
No problem. This is Councilor Murphy used to love this. This is our dashboard, and I'll just go over it real quick with you. And what we look at here is we run this monthly. I actually ran this from the beginning of the year. If you look at the first box upper left hand corner, that tells us our percentage of ALS advanced life support calls versus what we call our basic life support calls, whether you're doing IV or not. So you can see it basically they're almost 50-50 in a system with paramedics that usually runs a little bit higher, like 70-30. We do a lot of psychiatric calls in the city that eat up a lot of resources. So you'll see that we do almost 50-50 BLS versus ALS, because we pick a lot of the same people up every day too, unfortunately. But the next box, if you look over, is our disposition. It tells you roughly, if you add the numbers up, for since the beginning of the year till now, we did 1,426 transports and refusals. So you can see the non-transports, we did 131 people where we showed up and they said no, they want to go to the hospital. But we did 1,295 where we actually brought them to the hospital in the last 4 months. We break it down even further on the non-transports, where nine of the calls that we didn't transport were basically, we were canceled en route. So. And then it really just breaks down into other things where our average on scene times, how long we're spending on scene. So you can see we're averaging about 20 minutes when we do an ambulance call on scene. The IVs and ETs, that's for our information to make sure our quality, like our quality care markers, we want to make sure those numbers are pretty high. We've had nine intubations, successful intubations, and 13 not. So we've done a total of, since the beginning of the year, 10 intubations. That mean, so what's that telling us? We've done 10 cardiac arrests already this year. And I will tell you, some of the numbers that don't report to you is I've been doing some numbers. Our Narcan usage is what the drug we use to bring our heroin addicts around, has increased by 1,000% from last year's quarter. So some of it is call volume's gone up. The other big contributing factor to the Narcan usage is also we're using 2 to 3 times more of it per patient. So in the past, as a paramedic, I may give you maybe 0.4 to 1 milligram to bring you around. We're seeing patients now, we're giving them 6 milligrams of the drug, which to bring it around, because they are so far gone nowadays when we're finding them.
It's
much stronger. They're cutting this heroin with fentanyl and everything else. We're finding people, if it wasn't for somebody finding them and actually getting us on scene quickly, you wouldn't have that problem next week, because they wouldn't be there. They're really that bad. I've never seen it this bad in my life. I don't even know where to start. And, yeah.
How many fatal overdoses have there been?
I don't know what was reported into the police department. The police department actually tracks that, because the other part of it where we may not see maybe a fatal overdose where we get there, it's too late.
Yeah.
Well, all we'll do is just write it up as a dead on scene and turn it over to the medical examiner. So the police actually track all that number.
Right.
The VA and the jail actually have their own numbers too as well.
Okay.
So they report directly and they don't report through us. So I just tell you, I went in for looking for buying of supplies. That's my biggest number. I do track to see which one went up the most. Huge spike in Narcan purchases. And we're also, we stock off the hospital a lot of times too, which is really good. We're also supplying the PD on an informal exchange, I guess I'll put it that way. So, but if the cops use one, we'll give them one of ours, you know. So we're helping out supplying PD. So we're trying to control expenses across the city by, you know, looking at this. And it's working, but I will tell you, we're giving a lot more of it. So
one of the huge things with the epidemic out there is basically our increase in EMS supplies. As John said, we're administering Narcan, but we're also getting on scene that if they're not breathing, we have to use some, you know, interventions to put tubes in them to help them breathe. We have to get the defib out and ready. And once we open that equipment, we basically can't use it again. So I know I went over on my EMS equipment budget. I've been consulting with the mayor on that, letting him know. But that's been a huge spike, because when we go to these type of overdose calls, the guy's got to follow the protocol, and when they open up the equipment, basically we can't use it again, even if they don't use it. So we have to get rid of it. So we've seen an increase in our supplies because of that.
Yeah, you know, you break out an ambo bag, which you use to breathe for the patient. You know, there's $20. The big ones, we call these either IO needles, where we'll put a drill a hole right into the bone itself to make quick access. That's very quick. That needle is $110 for one needle. You know, instead of defib pad, you slap on the patient. You know, $50. It adds up so quick, and then Medicare will turn around and give you like, you know, $400 for the call if that's all they have. You know, Mass Health. So it eats up huge amounts of supplies right away. You know, it's, you know, and we're buying them ourselves. So the only supply we get from the hospital supplies, most of the time supplies us with our medications. But when they're short on meds, we have to buy those ourselves too. So you know, we're buying, you know, so we spend, it's not, we're going to be looking at $55,000.
So when I was watching my budget and our EMS supplies in January were heading up there, I tasked him with why.
Yeah.
And really the overdose calls were really the driver, because of the amount of supplies and equipment that we have to use, and basically with that. So we revised our budget. We certainly increased it for next year going forward. And
when you have somebody who has an overdose and then you administer with what you have to do, how long does it take for them to become alert with them?
Instantly. It's pretty
instantly?
Quick. Yeah. So here's a problem we run into, and I've asked the district attorney's office we need a fix for it. PD gets on scene, and we do a simple assessment like you would anybody, find an unconscious patient. You know, you don't go to Narcan right away, but you see if they're breathing. If they're not breathing, you give them a couple of reps, right? So, and part of that is the cops are then giving them the Narcan. Cops give them the Narcan up the nose because they're carrying it. We get there, the guy's alert, oriented, and no. So, you know, person, place, and time. He can make his own consent. He can honestly say, I don't want to go to the hospital, because he knows that Narcan's going to wear off before the heroin does, and he's going to get his high back in 20 minutes. And there's nothing we can do to make that guy go to the hospital. He signs a refusal. We tell him he's going to overdose again. We can tell him he's going to die, but there's nothing we can do. And we may go back in 20 minutes and pick him back up again. And as a paramedic, I used to be able to find a heroin overdose. And I'll be honest, we do IVs. We went straight up the nose. So I could control how much I was giving. Cop has no choice. Cop has to spray 2 milligrams, 1 milligram up each nose. That's it, period. Starts there. I, as a paramedic, have a choice. I can say, I'm going to give enough. I would just get enough to get these guys breathing, because I don't have to bag them the whole trip in. And I take them to the hospital. If they're unconscious, they can't say no. We don't have that option anymore. So with PD shooting the Narcan, by the time we get on the scene, yeah, they're already alert and oriented. We're seeing a lot of times where they turn around and, okay, I'm not going to hospital. There's nothing we can do.
And then you'll see them again.
And we'll see them again. Yeah, so I feel it's very frustrating for our crews doing the work. You can understand that. Especially, like, I mean, I know myself. I hate seeing heroin overdoses, because there's nothing we're a reactive organization. We're not the proactive. There's nothing that we can do other than try to tell them you need to get help. But it is a disease. There's nothing, you know, it's not these are bad people. It's just that there's something wired. Their body craves it. You know, it is a sickness. And you see it. It doesn't discriminate. It's one of those drugs that just takes off. It could be anybody. So unfortunately, you know, and the best we can do is try to, you know, at that moment, try to do the best job that we can do for them, you know. I know PD has some stuff in place to try to help people. There's all Hampshire Hope. I belong to that committee doing all that, but I just don't see effects. I wish I had the answer. God, I would love to get to it, you know. But all we can do is try to take care of the best we can do. So, but yeah, that's pretty much our dashboard. The second page, if you look at the bottom left corner, that's just our monthly trending, and that kind of shows you know, we're averaging about 300 to 350 calls a month in EMS, and that. And pretty much that's what we use that for, is to see how our EMS call range is. You know, are we seeing any major spikes? At the first of the year, we had a major spike. We had a lot of heroin overdoses right around Christmas time and in the first of the year. So you can see where we spiked up to 362 calls for that month, and then we leveled back down to the 300 call amount. You know, so that's what we use that trending for. We try to look at the numbers ahead of time, but And we report to the Department of Public Health and everybody else, Office of Emergency Medical Services, on anything we do to try to see, you know, is there a public health issue going on out there? The DA's office is fantastic to deal with as well there. They're always there supporting us and asking us for our numbers, and then we deal with the medical examiner's office on a daily basis too for people, so.
Anybody else have questions?
Do you respond to many overdoses in other towns?
Yes, we do. Northampton Fire Rescue is one of the few 24/7 paramedic services. Like where I live in Huntington and that, they have paramedics, but they only run certain hours a day.
Yeah.
Some of the surrounding communities. So we go out, we intercept a lot of communities. We go to Hatfield a lot of times,
okay,
too, for calls. So anybody that doesn't have a paramedic little truck, they're going to call us. And that's by state protocol. They have to have the ability to call paramedics. So we're at, you know.
That's for all calls.
Yeah, everything. We can be any. And basically, if it comes in at a certain level of call to the dispatch center, so Northampton Control, which is state police for everybody around us, we are the ones that have our own. Goes through the call and says, all right, this is a paramedic level call. They'll send the local responders out, so like Hatfield maybe go out to what they call EMT level.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, they're calling down that say, we need you to respond out there as well, and we'll go out there with them. You know, we do a lot of those calls. We charge for that service to those communities. It's a minimal amount, but you know, it's free. We get $300 to run out to another community to provide paramedic service. That's so.
Anyone else?
Can I ask just a question? I probably should have posed it in advance,
no.
But so if there's not much detail at this time, that's perfectly fine. But I've gotten some questions about emergency response with regards to freight that travels through the city.
Mm-hmm.
Every once in a while you read about, you know, there'll be a spill or something. And I imagine there are emergency protocols in place and plans for that. I don't know if you could just say a brief word about response plans in case there's a chemical spill or something.
I mean, basically, we have basically set plans for if we have an incident on the rail over there. I mean, the state has hazardous materials teams. Actually, myself and John Davin are members of that, so that if there was a spill, basically we could call that resource in. All our officers have been through basically the protocols to help identify what's on the freight. So basically they're first on scene, need to evaluate what's leaking, what's spilling, or what is the product that's involved. And if it did involve hazardous materials, we go right to basically activating the state team and getting resources out there.
Okay.
And moving that.
Okay. And there's no kind of advance information about materials that run through the city?
Unfortunately for railroads, they don't provide you that information.
No.
Basically, it's their tracks there, and they can move what they need to on that. So
your fixed facilities, like you know, they call them your tier two reporting sites.
Okay.
They are mandated to report to us every year.
Okay.
What they hold for hazardous materials. So any tier two facility in the city, we get a copy of it. We get a copy of their hazardous material stuff. And then we also send a copy to the Regional Emergency Planning Committee, which I sit on, and that committee actually manages all that information. So we, you know, there are, you know, fixed facilities. There's a lot, but as the chief said, with the rail, anything that'll fit, they'll move.
Yeah, even highway and stuff, highway, rail.
Okay.
There's really no reporting requirements for things coming through a community.
Is that tier one, or is that what's tier one?
For hazmat.
Yeah, tier two is a fixed.
Yeah, tier two is just the term they use.
It's a term they use for reporting requirements.
Reporting requirements.
A tier one, basically, tier two is basically for communities or businesses that have so much of a product on site.
Yeah.
Like a tier one, I think they file with the EPA and DEP, where if they have lesser amounts. The tier two is when they have larger quantities.
Quantity.
And that kicks in the requirement to report to the public safety officials of the community.
All right. Well, thank you. Every once in a while, again, we have these Ward 3 issues.
Yeah.
So
well, you got the telephone right through the cell.
Yes. So, thank you.
Well, I'm curious. Even though I'm not Ward 3, I'm curious about this too. In a general way, you have a sense of the type of hazmat stuff that is coming through on rail.
There's everything we've seen.
There's our resident training.
Majority of what you're seeing coming through the city is liquefied propane gas. Or boxcars of paper going to the paper companies, Mount Tom or down in Holyoke. You'll find a few boxcars with minor stuff. Most of your fertilizer and all that stuff stays Hatfield to Deerfield North. You know, they've got two big fertilizer places to the north. You'll occasionally see an empty car come down through because they'll drop on their way through, pick it up, take it down to Holyoke, and then bring it all the way back on their way through. But as far as this, anything that we have dangerous is heading to either Mount Tom or heading to Holyoke.
And the LPG is going from where to where, generally?
I don't know where it's coming from, but it comes out of the Deerfield Yard and heads down to Holyoke Power.
Yeah.
I think most of it's coming out of Boston where they're shipping it.
Yeah, it comes in by ship.
So they're just trucking it out. Rail's become the mode of transportation where it's certainly cheaper than over the road. So that's where you've seen the uptick in basically rails, trains moving product out through there. And certainly with the improvements in the tracks and stuff, I would say that we'll probably easily see more freight moved.
Mm. But it's also, year, with the new tracks, it's also a lot safer than it was.
Yeah, faster. it's considered high-speed rail, right?
Right, but the freights are limited to 40 miles an hour
through
this area. So yeah. But with the better rails, your chances of derailing is really slim.
And actually, with our last promotional exam for deputy chief, we always give them a large incident to work through, and usually we use a fire, but deputy chief McQuestion put it together this year and actually used the Amtrak hitting a car or a bus down at the intersection by the Pride Station on King Street.
And it was a Subaru.
Damon Road. It was a Subaru.
So Tim's, I was the one that had to take that test, that's what I'm saying.
Tim's our resident train expert, so.
Any more questions? Well, thank you.
Thank you very much.
And we just have a few more items of business to take care of, but I think that concludes our report from
Thank you again.
All right, and I did just quickly talk to the mayor out in the hallway about the appointment, and I suggested to him that we talk about maybe getting together on the 19th before the city council meeting, and then we'll just be able to report. Thank you. I think recommendation at the council meeting. So does that seem like that would work out for folks to meet at 6 o'clock here? What do you think, Pam? Is that going to work for you?
Stay through till.
For the whole night, right? So anyway, that's a good one. So maybe we could meet at 6 o'clock. Let the mayor know.
Yeah. I don't know if Dennis, if Councilor Bidwell was here when you talked about that, were you?
Yeah, I was.
And
so basically, it's an appointment just like any other appointment that we get from the mayor's office, department heads. So we are the committee that gives the recommendation back to the full council. So we'll give ourselves half an hour or so to meet with the new director of public works. And
so that would, the director appointee would not come before public works committee, just here?
I think just here, yeah. I think just here, I think that's why David was really concerned that we have a special meeting so that he can get her up and going. I think this is the only committee that she would be required to come to, and we could also have her come to the new Board of Public Works, Department of Public Works committee. But then her appointment, starting up wouldn't hinge on that.
Right.
Because
we'll be able to report back a recommendation to the full council, and then she'll be able to be appointed.
Yes, and
Jim
Lerillo is all done Friday, because I saw him today for the press conference, and he's all done Friday.
Counselor.
Would we ever do it like we do the finance committee and have a city services committee within the city council agenda? Since I don't imagine that, well, the questioning will not be terribly lengthy, it will be substantial. But just another thought, if that were easier, have it within the city council meeting.
Right.
Instead of 6 o'clock, you mean?
Yeah, it might be of general public interest as well. As you can see, we don't attract much of that money.
So what would be required would be to have, to set aside a time at the council meeting to have a subcommittee meeting prior to, that's fine with me. I mean, if we want to do that instead.
Just a thought, yeah.
Do you think that we can work that out with council president? For the 19th?
Yeah, I would only say that, that the council would have to suspend its council rules because the consent agenda, approving the appointment will be on the consent agenda, so depending on when we sort of...
Before that.
Take
right, we would have to do that before.
Right. I like this idea because, it's a really visible and important position, and there might be broader interest among other council members as well as the public. But also, it's not a big deal. But I would have a lot of difficulty making it to a 6 o'clock meeting. And I could, but I have to move a bunch of things around.
And so, I was envisioning that we would probably have a half an hour meeting with the prospective DPW chief. So we would just have to see if we could schedule that in. What do you think, Pam?
That's fine.
Yeah. So if we would do it before finance, we would probably do it at the beginning of the meeting.
That's the way you want to do it,
correct?
Yeah. I like that.
You mean before?
I mean, look at the Board of Health.
Before
we used to do the interviewing right on the floor.
Right, right.
Before the communications from the mayor, maybe.
That's fine.
So we would suspend, we would order a business to have a subcommittee meeting, and then folks could be prepared with their questions, or we would ask her to make a brief presentation. Okay. So I will get back to the mayor and let him know that this committee wants to have that meeting within the regular city council meeting.
Sounds like a plan.
And that she should be prepared to come to the council meeting that night.
Just a procedural question. So any appointment that comes to this committee goes on the consent agenda, no matter what it is, as opposed to an actual agenda item for full?
I think so. I think our recommendations, recommendations back from the committee. And then we can always pull it, but anyone can pull anything out that they want for any reason.
Right. Okay.
And I assume there's discretion where you could pull it out in advance if we saw a reason to.
But in this case here, we'll be pulling it out.
Yeah.
Well, we'll be pulling it out in this case here because we'll be. We don't have to pull it out of the consent agenda. It can still go. We just won't know what the recommendation will be until after we have the.
Okay.
Great.
Good idea.
So
the
is on the consent agenda for this coming Thursday because you're referring it out to committees.
Right.
Okay. And this person is in an acting capacity in the meantime, just because the position needs to be attended to.
I think that's what I read.
The mayor's statement correctly. Okay.
Right.
She's awesome.
Right.
Okay. Right.
He seemed quite concerned that we'd be able to, by the 19th, have that all.
He's got to.
Yeah. So, and it couldn't happen before the 19th.
Right.
So this way we'll just, I'll let him know that.
It's a good solution.
She should be prepared to come to the council meeting, and we'll have it within the context of the council meeting. All right, do we have a motion to approve the minutes of March 7th?
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
None opposed, no abstentions, okay, passes. We have two upcoming meetings, on June 7th, parking enforcement, June 28th, health. Have we heard anything from those, confirmation that, well, can we, is there anything that anybody has in particular that they would like to convey to either of these departments beyond a run-of-the-mill report?
Well, on parking enforcement, I know when there's a whole parking study done that the mayor presented a year or something. There was a lot of talk about new technologies, iPhone-based abilities to actually reserve a parking space or to know where they were parking. I'm just curious if any of that technology that was talked about in that parking study is being implemented, or what the timeline for its implementation might be. And I don't know, does that come before traffic and parking?
Yeah, although it's not, we haven't followed up very much after the parking study.
There's a lot of good stuff in that study. What's happening.
And there are some capital purchases. I think there's going to be upgrades to the ticketing machines in the parking lot and so forth. But some of the apps and the fancy stuff that Boston is doing, and I don't think we're doing that yet.
So who is actually reporting then from parking enforcement? Who would that be?
It would be Nancy Forrestal.
Is that the chair of the, we'll check through the mayor's office, I guess.
She's the head of parking enforcement, but they work for the collector/treasurer, so I don't know how that would play out in terms of...
I think that seems like the right person. Okay, any new business?
And just one thing on health, you had talked about, and maybe you don't even have to ask because it's so obvious that there would be an opioids focus to their report.
Right, they could
certainly want to be sure they come prepared to talk about that, as I'm mentioning, but anyway.
Right. Have you heard some about that today as well?
Yeah. So when we actually communicate with the health director, we'll just note that that was mentioned as a point of focus. All right.
You don't have to vote on these, do we?
I don't think so.
We're all set? Okay.
On vote on these being the upcoming meetings?
Yeah.
Well, you would know because it was your rule. So
I should know.
It doesn't hurt to vote on it.
This part of the rules is murky. And, yeah.
So it doesn't hurt to vote on it.
And I move we extend these two invitations as written.
Is there
so
a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No? Okay.
Thank you very much.
All right, any new business? And then motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Okay.
Okay.
Meeting's adjourned. Thank you.